decided to place Hesperus Baptist Camp in their will. And then they had already taken the money and they had placed it in a separate account. And they decided, rather than waiting for the day that they died, I don't know if that sounds weird to you, don't worry about it. Instead of waiting for that day, they decided to give it now. They gave it actually last Sunday through Emmanuel, and by Thursday or Friday, Emmanuel wrote a check to Hesperus Baptist Camp. And the reason I want to kind of tell you that whole story, I mean, you might be thinking about that as well, but Brian called me and he said, Clyde, I've got news, but he said, I want to be able to tell you in person. I don't want to leave it in a phone message. Okay. And he said, it's going to be really good news. So, I mean, it keeps you all wound up, you know, and you're ready for who knows what. And so I call him back and he said, would you like to guess how much money this family, and he told me this story, how much money this family gave to Hesperus Baptist Camp? I said, I have no idea. And he said, well, and it's some kind of, and so many cents, and so I won't get it just right. We'll I'll wait to see the number, but it's $142,000. And that, to me, was kind of, whoa! I mean, that was sort of a big, actually $5,000 causes my eyebrows to go up, but and maybe even $100 these days, but I just wanted to tell you, you and I, as God has led us and worked in our lives, have been faithful to support the camp, and we've been the beneficiaries of what goes on at Hesperus Baptist Camp. And we're not the only church, but there are several churches that have been more integrated, even as several of you helped in the retreat that was going on a week or so back, and those kinds of things, setting up the tent, the other things that took place. So I just thought that you'd want to know also about the huge financial gift. Now, the way Brian worded this, I said, well, our board will meet, and it won't be like that. But anyway, he said, hey, you know, this is enough money that if we had to close the camp for the rest of the year and wait to reopen it, we could still operate. And I said, yeah, but we're not going to look at it that way. anyway, God is blessed, and we're thankful, and I wanted to make sure I shared it with you. Other announcements I need to make. All right, let's pray. So before I pray, though, let's one other thing. So we're going to do a Pledge of Allegiance to the U.S. flag. We're going to do a Pledge of Allegiance to the Christian flag. And sing a couple of songs that are related to both of those, and then sing a few more songs before we do our scripture reading and kind of open into the rest of our worship time this morning and our message. So just to give you the heads up, that's what's taking place. Let's pray. Father, we thank you for this day. We can't imagine a couple hundred years ago what this day might have been like in this nation as these men the day before signed the Declaration of Independence. And I'm sure literally wondered when the shoe would fall, when the next thing would happen. And as those events unfolded, you blessed us with the birth of a new nation. Thank you for letting us be a part of it. Thank you for the heritage that you've given us in freedom. Thank you for the freedom that the gospel of Christ has had in this place and in this city and this nation. And we ask you to bless us, your people worshiping you together today. Bless us with your Holy Spirit, with your presence and power, and continue to bless us with the freedom that you've endowed us with when you created us. Thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. All right, we're going to have our missionary moments. Sorry, I set you guys up, didn't I? And then we'll be ready.
How's that?
Okay, got it.
right. Rob and Lisa Warren have a challenging mission field. They chose to move to Madison, Wisconsin in 2018 to reach 40,000 students at the University of Wisconsin. They planted a church there called Doxa, D-O-X-A. Yeah, well, the original Greek, I'm sure you know, for doxa meant common belief or popular opinion, which I thought was a strange name for a church. But their website explained that in the first and third century, the Septuagint translated the word doxa in its Hebrew meaning,
just like you said, what?
Praise, glory, splendor, grandeur. So that's where we get our word doxology. When these students accept Christ as their Savior and they graduate, or not, they'll not stay in Madison, but move to other parts of the country. So Rob and Lisa also prep these students to help plant new churches wherever they go. The scripture that Rob and Lisa base the church on is James 2:14-16. Just seems like James is just all over the place these days. You know, if you're attending the Wednesday night Bible study or the Thursday morning, you'll recognize this, but I'll repeat it. What good is it, brothers, if someone says he has faith but does not have works? If a brother or sister is poorly clothed and lacking in daily food, and one of you says to him, go in peace, be warmed, be filled, without giving them the things that they really need, what good is that? So when COVID-19 shut down the campus in Madison, Rob and Lisa felt that they had to somehow continue with their teaching in James. They decided to do a daily podcast and work through the entire book of Psalms with a special focus on how to respond to the physical, the moral, and the societal turmoil in today's world. And then I crossed something out here, so this may sound chopped to you. But Psalm 75 says, when the earth totters and all who dwell in it melt, it is I who have firmly set the pillars. And James is clear when he says that God's timing is perfect. So in addition to God being in control of the world today, remember we talked about that? The message that I got out of the podcast was to be still and know that I'm God and obey the commandments. And then works will naturally follow from that. Is that a true statement? Pretty much? I don't want to say something that's not right. Our church supports Rob and Lisa through the cooperative program, so we have an indirect path of every student who comes to faith in Christ. Let's play. Let's play for Rob and Lisa. You ready? Okay. Heavenly Father, thank you for speaking to me through the ministry of Rob and Lisa this morning. Even though our churches and our campuses have been shut down during the pandemic, with your guidance, they continue to reach the students who are seeking hope in a world that seems to be tottering out of control. We are so grateful that you have set the pillars and the foundations firmly under our feet. In Jesus' holy name, amen.
Thank you. All right, let's stand, and we'll have our pledge allegiance to the flag, and I'll try to be in this position, and then we'll sing. Then we'll pledge allegiance to the Christian flag. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. All right, if you want to remain standing, we're going to sing America the Beautiful. Now we're ready. Thank you, guys. It's 641 on your hymnal if you needed it.
Oh, beautiful for spacious skies, for amber waves of grain, for purple mountain majesties, above the fruited plain, America. with brotherhood from sea to shining sea.
Amen. And then we'll say our pledge of allegiance to the Christian flag. And I think we'll have it on the screen for us so we can see the words. I pledge allegiance to the Christian flag and to the Savior for whose kingdom it stands, one brotherhood, uniting all Christians in service and love. And then we'll sing God of Our Fathers, 642 in hymnal. Of Jesus is our next song. It's 163 in your hymnal.
Jesus, deeper than the mighty rolling sea.
Sparrow. Sevilla D. Martin wrote this song, but there's this lady that was associated with the Billy Graham Crusade for years that sang it well, and then after her, George Beverly Shea, right?
Okay.
93, his eyes on the sparrow.
Why should I feel discouraged? Why should the shadows come? Why should my heart be lonely and long for heaven and home? When Jesus is my portion, my constant friend is He.
Is what we're looking at today. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, O my soul. While I live, I will praise the Lord. I will sing praises to my God while I have my being. Do not put your trust in princes, nor in a son, that's a little letter, son of man, in whom there is no help. His spirit departs. He returns to his earth, and that very day his plans perish. Happy is he who has the God of Jacob for his help, whose hope is in the Lord, his God. Every time the psalm uses that word Lord, it's all in caps. It's Yahweh, the name that God introduced himself to Moses, who made heaven and earth, the sea, and all that is in them, who keeps truth forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord gives freedom to the prisoners. The Lord opens the eyes of the blind. The Lord raises those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the strangers. He relieves the fatherless and the widow. But the way of the wicked he turns upside down. The Lord shall reign forever, your God, O Zion, to all generations. Praise the Lord. Let's pray. Matter of fact, Mike, would you lead us in that prayer? I know you're not Mike, but I can Mike you. There you are.
Heavenly Father, thank you for this day. Thank you for this opportunity we have to worship you publicly. Whether we can worship you publicly or not, we can still worship you privately. We pray that we do every day as an expression of our love for you and our gratitude for your Son. Take this offering and bless it to your purpose. In Christ's name, amen.
Amen. I can't remember the number now. It's 274. Pick another number. Nope. Well, I'll look it up.
I wasn't fast enough to snatch her book. No, but that's a good one. Well, I wanted to read some of the lyrics from the song that we ought to sing sometime, because the lyrics are, "Lord, you are so faithful." And I wasn't looking well enough over her shoulder to see the number of the song. And, I don't know about you guys, but when you have books that are like this, they look kind of like my Bible over a period of time. Now I can't find it at all. So, anyway, that's okay. Enough time wasted on that deal. This I always hate to say this weekend, but I want to say this weekend. Culturally, we have. Thank you. 254. Is that? Two out of three doesn't count. We've culturally scooted our work week and our calendar week so that we call this the weekend. Have you noticed that? Every now and then I try to, it's kind of like a friend of mine that used to always say Merry Christmas. But anyway, so I'm trying to get the emphasis back on the right syllable and say that Monday is not the beginning of the week, right? Sunday is. But yet we have this kind of weekend view towards Sunday. And so since yesterday was Independence Day, it just seemed like this was the right day rather than last week to have kind of a God and country emphasis and to talk about the freedom that we so cherish, we so take for granted. But anyway, so let me just read a few lyrics real quickly to this song. Like the sun that rises every day, you are so faithful, Lord. You are faithful like the rain that you send, and every breath that I breathe, you are so faithful, Lord. And the chorus at the end says, you'll still be faithful, you'll still be faithful when the stars refuse to shine and time is no more. You'll still be faithful, you'll still be faithful, Lord. And the reality is that God is faithful even when we aren't. That is the good news about grace and about and the message that we get to share, whether it's weekly in this sort of a format or you and I do daily as we come in contact with other folks in our lives. And I think that is pretty special. And so when Janice plays this song about how faithful God is, I know that's probably not good grammar either, but we'll do our best. We are reminded every time that He is faithful to you and to me. I want to make sure that we say thank you to each one who has served in our branches of the military this morning. This is a good day to recognize you again and say thank you. You, like those brave patriots of the 1770s, 250 years ago, by the way, have given us, and you have helped maintain the freedoms that we so greatly cherish. And then, as I said earlier, most of the time, we probably just take for granted. So God bless you to each person that's here today, each man and or woman that served us. So before we get to John chapter 8, I want to ask a question. What events led up to the Declaration of Independence on July 4th, 1776? And there were quite a list of events. And I guess the way I wanted to start this is I wanted to say, hey, some guys didn't just get together in a meeting hall to hammer out a declaration to get out the English rule that day. The Declaration of Independence was a culmination of years of intolerable treatment of the colonies by Great Britain and the beginning of the greatest social and governmental experiment that's ever been recorded in history. I think that's huge. Mike may corner me later and say, no, there were empires that were far greater, and yeah, they probably were, but were they as of the people and by the people? Were they as representative
I'm going to say it. Were they as compassionate? we could maybe debate that today, but anyway. Were they as compassionate to the population as this government is? Okay, somebody's going to kind of hit me with bricks at the end of this, but I think after we think about it, maybe you'll still buy it. So there were some key events. And it goes back to at least 1651, the first Navigation Acts were passed by British Parliament. But by the time you get to the 1760s, the Proclamation of 1763, the Sugar Act of 1764, the Currency Act, the Stamp Act of 1765, the Quartering Act, the Declaratory Act, the Townsend Revenue Acts, the Boston Massacre in 1770, the Tea Act in 1773, the Coercive Acts, in 1774, the Massachusetts Government Act, same year, First Continental Congress, same year, Lexington and Concord, the first fighting in 1775, and the Battle of Bunker Hill. All of these events were more than a decade prior to the Declaration of Independence. And then even that year, and the year preceding, the Second Continental Congress in May of 1775 convened in Philadelphia. It elected John Hanson as the President of the United States, and Congress assembled. And they presented this petition of grievances to the King, King George III of England, and it continued to remain unanswered. They put together an army in 1775. In March of 1776, Congress passes the privateering or the piracy resolution, allowing colonists to arm vessels in order to, they called it, cruise on the enemies of these United Colonies. So all of these things led up to this point where this declaration was finally developed by a relatively small committee of men, and then voted upon to get the wording as we have it today. Quite a few fascinating stories just centered around that declaration. Worth doing our history to understand that. Well, we gather every Sunday to look at Scripture, and to listen to the Holy Spirit speak from the Bible, not just to review history, as fascinating as that may be. So I want us to get to Scripture, but I want us to look at a few verses before we get there. And Becky, we're going to be talking about James again, because it relates to, but first we're going to talk about Peter, 1 Peter 2:16. Before he says this, he says, "Submit yourselves to every ordinance of man, for the Lord's sake." And then at 1 Peter 2:16 he says, "As free, not using liberty as a cloak for vice, but as bondservants of God. We are made free in Christ, yet we are commanded to obey civil authorities. We're under the perfect law of liberty, as James calls it in James 1:25, the law of love." Jesus tells us what that law is after a Pharisee lawyer asked, "Teacher, which is the great commandment in the law?" That's at Matthew 22. The greatest commandment and the second greatest, he said, was, "You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your mind." And then second, he says, "You shall love your neighbor as yourself," in Matthew 22, 34 through 39. We are under the law of liberty. We are free indeed. Finally, I get to the kind of the punchline for the title of the message today, Free Indeed. Let's read, I'm going to kind of truncate the reading a little bit, and we're going to read John chapter 8, verses 31 through 36. It looked to me that I was trying to figure out where to cut this off and still go all the way to the end of chapter 8, because Jesus has quite a discussion with the Pharisees there, but I think we'll get the picture if we stop at 36. Then Jesus said to those Jews who believed him, "If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. They answered him, We are Abraham's descendants, and have never been in bondage to anyone. How can you say you will be made free? Jesus answered them, Most assuredly I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave of sin. And a slave does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides forever. Therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. So in this passage, and maybe we could stop right there, but I don't want more to say. In this passage, we have a formula of progression to freedom that we can follow from Jesus' own words. First, we abide in Jesus' word, and that allows us to be disciples indeed, which causes one to know the truth. Jesus said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me, in John 14:6. And then that truth makes one free. So you can see how we go through this progression to come to that point. But the reality, and the reality about these Pharisees that day, is that they were in this place called denial, right? And you and I might be there as well. I know some of you have heard me say this, so one of my pet peeves, and I believe that it's come out of my mouth a few times, so I'm not going to tell you the other pet peeve. But anyway, you talk to somebody or you ask them for something, and they say, no thanks, I'm good. Well, a couple of times I've gone on a real tirade after somebody has said that. Are you really? But anyway, verse 33. These Jewish Pharisees didn't need to be free because they said they are free, right? They said, we have never been in bondage to anyone. Now, the question for you, knowing all the history of the nation of Israel, is that true? Absolutely not. False coming out of their mouth. Okay, just checking here. Since Abraham, Father Abraham, they called him, the Israelites had been in bondage in Egypt. Now, I believe that they were not in bondage 400 years, but they were in Egypt 400 years, according to the record. The Assyrians had ruled them, the Babylonians. At this point, they were under Rome. The Pharisees couldn't execute someone, even if their law demanded it. And then the thought hit me as I was trying to think about, okay, we are free men, and we have no allegiance to anyone. Our father is Abraham. Were some of these Pharisees that Jesus talked to that day, were they at his trial before Pilate? When they answered Pilate, you know where I'm going with that, we have no king but Caesar. Square that up, guys. John 19:15. These Pharisees were living in denial. Perhaps you are too. You may think you were free, but in reality, you were doing as Jesus later says to these Pharisees. If you read the rest of that passage all the way to the end of chapter 8, he says, you are of your father, all right. The devil. Oh, man. That's harsh. If you're living your life for yourself, for your wants and needs, without offering yourself to Christ, you are living as a child of Satan. You are not free. Janice had a bunch of clients at social services for years who wanted to remain free. They didn't have a schedule to keep. They had no financial problems because somebody else always shouldered that responsibility. They were free to get up or continue sleeping. They were free to abuse alcohol and drugs. They were free from most conventional things, which they would say enslave each of us upright citizens. Janice arranged a home for several of her clients so that they did not have to live on the street or camp out over the wintertime, and one client would sleep outside of her house and use the house to store things. That sounds like a pretty good plan, other than it's more like she hoarded things, and not all of those things were unperishable. That's the way I'll say that. In other words, it smelled like rot around there all the time, and the rest of the neighbors wanted her out. But anyway, you may say, like the Pharisees standing and praying, he said, I thank you, Lord, that I am not like those sinners. I fast twice a week. I give tithes of all I possess. Then there was this tax collector standing far off who would not raise his eyes to heaven, but beat his breast. That's a form of showing complete humility and confession of sin before God, who says, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. In Luke 18, 9 through 14. So who is free? Jesus says that the tax collector went to his house justified and not the self-righteous guy. There is no rescue for a person who does not need help. There's my profound thought for the day. No thanks, I'm good. Denial of your slavery only limits your access to Holy God. So let's try to think about, well, what's real slavery? Verse 34, Jesus says, if you sin, you're a slave of sin. And he uses the analogy of a slave and his master to make the point that a slave obeys his master because he belongs to him. Slaves have no will of their own. They are literally in bondage to their masters. When sin is our master, we are unable to resist it. But by the power of Christ, to overcome the power of sin, and Paul said in Romans 6:18, you have been set free from sin and have become slaves to righteousness. Once we come to Christ in repentance and receive forgiveness for sin, we are empowered by the Holy Spirit who comes to live within us. And it's by His power that we're able to resist sinning and become slaves of righteousness. A slave is not a family member. Only a son is. But a son can make a slave a family member forever. In verse 36, Jesus says, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. Now, Jesus' disciples belong to Him, and we want to do things that please Him. This means that the children of God obey Him and live in freedom from habitual sin. We can do this because Jesus has set us free from the slavery of sin, and thus we're no longer under its penalty of death and separation from God. So, real freedom. If we look at real slavery, what is real freedom? Even slaves in our country before the Emancipation Proclamation knew freedom in Christ. Now, I hope nothing about this message endorses slavery or prejudice in law enforcement, business, or housing, or all these other kinds of things. And as I said last week, I want to keep saying it this way, all lives matter. But these slaves, in their status as slaves, mostly in the South, they wrote songs that we still sing, and I'm probably going to get myself in some kind of political incorrectness for sure, but they're called Negro spirituals. That's the title. And you look them up in the dictionary. Anybody have a dictionary? Or when you look them up in the encyclopedia, anybody know what an encyclopedia is? Anyway. I would say, Jillian, do you know what an encyclopedia is? But anyway, I won't do that to you. when you Google them, there we go. That's a little closer. Anyway, Negro spirituals, songs about Jesus, about salvation, about freedom from sin, freedom from the law. Songs like Down by the Riverside, Dry Bones, Every Time I Feel the Spirit, Free at Last, Give Me Jesus. We sang that sometime in the last month or, well, four in our worship service. Give Me That Old Time Religion. And There Is a Balm in Gilead. Those are all Negro spirituals. How can you sing about freedom when you're under slavery? And the answer is, slave or free, politically, economically, socially, you can be free in Christ. When you accept the truth of Christ into your life, you are free. Well, we may go to freedom in stages. And really, if you in Christian jargon, this is called sanctification. It's a process of gaining freedom from the chains that bind us. Now, I just listed two. Chains like worshiping false idols, like thinking that our government can save us. That's a big mistake according to Scripture. I guess I want to make sure I emphasize that on a day when we're emphasizing the Declaration of Independence. We cannot. We must be involved in our government, but we cannot count on our government to save us. Chains like decisional habits, which limit our ability to relate to God, distancing ourselves from a close personal relationship with Him, those chains can be broken and are broken by our trust, our faith in Christ. So I wanted to just read a passage to close our message this morning, and then we're going to have a closing song that gives you an opportunity to respond. And it's from Galatians chapter 5, verses 13 and 14. For you, brethren, have been called to liberty, only do not use liberty as an opportunity for the flesh, but through love serve one another. For all the law is fulfilled in one word, even in this, you shall love your neighbor as yourself. As we think about how the Holy Spirit would have us respond, I'll ask you to stand. We're going to sing 174 in our hymnal. And it's, I gave my life for thee. And we'll just sing a verse of it, but I'll give you an opportunity to do that. And if there's a decision that you need to make that includes me by coming forward, I ask you to do that. Otherwise, right where you stand, continue to commit your life to Jesus.
I gave my life for thee, my precious blood I shed, that thou might ransom me and quicken from the dead. I gave my life for thee, what hast thou given for me?
Today. It's good to have some folks back with us, several couples, and we look forward to every opportunity we get to be together. So I'm going to at least embarrass one.